All right, let's begin with a word of prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you that this morning, Lord, as we worship you, that we are reminded that, Lord, we don't worship you, Lord, with our own strength, Lord, because many times, Lord, we find our own strength lacking, energy and so forth. But, Lord, you're the one that gives us the strength. You're the one that gives us the energy, Lord, to worship you and to praise you. And so, Lord, we experience more of you working in us, Lord, when we are weak. And so, Lord, we ask that you would set our hearts on you, Lord. Focus, Lord. We're able to worship together, Lord, and we praise you. At the same time, Lord, we know that you also want to speak to each of us, Lord, that so in the worship, in the service, Lord, that we would encounter you, Lord, in a very real way. And what you say to each of us, Lord, would stay with us, Lord, and encourage us and even sometimes admonish and rebuke us, but always to draw us closer to you. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. For responsive reading, read from Psalm 19, verses 7 to 14. I'll read the odd verses. Please read the even verses with me. The law of the Lord is perfect, restoring the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true. They are righteous altogether. They are more desirable than gold, yes, than much pure gold, sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, your servant is warned by them. In keeping them, there is great reward. Who can discern his errors? Acquit me of hidden faults. Also keep your servant back from presumptuous sins. Let them not rule over me. Then I will be innocent, and I will be blameless of great wrongdoing. Let's read verse 14 together. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Let us stand. Yet not I, but Christ in me.
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. For my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but to Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken. For by my side, the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing. For in my need, His power is displayed. To this I hold, my shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley he will lead. one, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ in me. No fate I dread, I know I am forgiven. The future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and he was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are released. I can sing, I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me. With every breath, I long to follow Jesus. For he has said that he will bring me home. And day by day, I know he will renew me. Until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Yes, Lord Jesus, even now, Lord, you are working in our lives. You are working in our hearts. Lord, it is you who calls us to sing, to worship. Lord, and pray that you will give us strength. Give strength to your redeemed as we sing out. Lord Jesus, we thank you and we praise you.
Seems like all I could see was the struggle. Haunted by ghosts that lived in my past. Bound up in shackles of all my failures. Wondering how long is this gonna last? And you look at this prisoner and say to me, son, stop fighting a fight that's already been won. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain. Now I know who I used to be. I am redeemed. I'm redeemed. All my life I have been called unworthy. Named by the voice of my shame and regret. Whisper, shall lift up your head. I remember, oh God, you're not done with me yet. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain. Now I'm not who I used to be. Because I don't have to be. The old man inside of me, as his day is long and gone. Because I got a new name, a new life, I'm not the same. And a hope that will carry me home. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake on these heavy chains and wipe away every stain. Cause I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed. You set me free. I'll shake all these heavy chains and wipe away every stain. I'm not who I used to be. God, I'm not who I used to be. Jesus, I'm not who I used to be. Cause I am redeemed. God redeemed.
Let us pray. Yes, Lord. Our lives were never the same when we have a face-to-face encounter with you. When you change not only the destination, but the trajectory of our lives. Lord, and you are still doing that today. And Lord, it is only through worship, Lord, that we can be reminded every day that we are the redeemed, that you are our redeemer. And while we may have recollections of our lives before, Lord, the life we live now, we live for you. Lord, help us to live up to what it means to be your redeemed. Help us to live out what it means to live a new self, a new life. The old has gone, the new has come. Lord, pray that you will help us to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. Lord, and whether it's those around us, Lord, even our own selves, that we will see, Lord, that we continue to live, Lord, to glorify your name as your redeemed. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Now is the time for our offering. I'd like to ask Carson to help with the offering. Let us pray for the offering. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this time of offering. Lord, at every step in the service, Lord, these are reminders. These are reminders that we're not here by our own strength, by our own wits, by our own wisdom, by our own planning. Lord, that we can live the lives that we are living now. Lord, the freedom and everything we have, it is because of you. And Lord, we are also reminded that by offering yourself as a sacrificial lamb on the cross, that you made all these things possible. So Lord, in the same way, that we would also obey and bring our offering before you. Because Lord, we know that this offering opens up possibilities so that many more people may hear the good news. They would have the opportunity to hear and to make a decision for themselves, Lord, to receive you as their Lord and Savior. We're thankful for the opportunity that we're given, and we pray that through this offering that others will have the same opportunity. May this offering be used, Lord, for your kingdom's work, for your church. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, so for announcements, there will be a church council meeting today at room 107 at 1:30 p.m. So all pastors, elders, and deacons, please attend. So we have, as you can see, we have some families, couples going out of town because this is fall break, okay? So please keep each other in your prayers. For those who are not here with us, I pray that God will watch over them in their travels and bring them back safely. Last but not least, this is the... for now, this is the last time that we'll be worshiping in this space. So starting next Sunday, so starting October, we will start every week instead of 11:30, we'll start at 10 a.m. and we will be in Social Hall. And after that, there will be a short time of sermon discussion, and then we'll have English / youth Sunday school classes that will start at 11:30 a.m. Okay, so... please keep this in your prayers. This is, we've done joint services, we've done separate services before for English and Chinese, but this will be something new for us to meet in a different space. Okay, but hopefully, Social Hall is where we'll have a space that will be where we can feel like it's it's where we can draw everyone, close together, okay, as we worship. And most importantly of all, that we focus on the one that we're worshiping, our Lord Jesus. Okay, so please keep it in your prayers. And we'll be reminding you, you guys also throughout the week, okay, so you don't show up at 11:30 instead of 10 o'clock next week, okay? Thank you. All right, so it's good to be back with all of you. As some of you guys know, our family has been out for a little less than 2 weeks, visiting family in Taiwan and also a short stopover in Japan. And so as I was talking to some of you, family vacation, it's great. It's a break, but it can also be tiring. I certainly felt that with the two, a little less than 2 weeks short trip. We got back last night, so I'm kind of running on fumes right now. but the strength of the Lord is enough for us. One of the things that you know, I also realized about going on family vacations is that whether it's with family or maybe you have opportunity to, you know, hang out with friends for an extended period of time. You know, it can be a very revealing experience because it reveals much about who we are, our own characters, as well as that of our loved ones or friends. And that also means that there is a great potential for conflict during family vacations. But of course, you probably already know that. We've been doing a sermon series on the book of Ruth. And so as we are moving through today, we'll get to the end of chapter 3, and we have one more chapter to go. As the book of Ruth moves toward its conclusion and ending, we can see at every step of the way that the character of both Ruth and also Boaz. In the passage today, we're going to take a closer look at Boaz's character and what it means for us as believers reading the book of Ruth. Okay, so we're going to read the God's word from Ruth chapter 3, verses 14 through 18. So before we get to that, so I was thinking about, okay, well, what photo do I want to put up from the vacation? I know you guys are bored by vacation photos, okay? So don't worry, this will be the only one, okay? But so we were visiting this, so this was in Japan. We're visiting a place where there are a lot of ponds and a lot of fish. And among the things that, you know, kids can fight over is we made the mistake of, you know, giving them fish food to, you know, feed the fish with, right? So of course they're gonna fight over who's gonna feed what fish and how much to throw out and stuff like that, okay? But, you know, but we survived. The ponds there were actually very clear. I guess these are koi probably. As we look back on the photo, it just, you know, reminder of, you know, our experiences, you know, wherever we went. Okay, so let's read from God's word. Starting with verse 14 in Ruth chapter 3. So she lay at his feet until morning and got up before one person could recognize another. And he said, Do not let it be known that the woman came to the threshing floor. Again, he said, give me the shawl that is on you and hold it. So she held it, and he measured 6 measures of barley and laid it on her. Then she went into the city. When she came to her mother-in-law, she said, how did it go, my daughter? And she told her all that the man had done for her. She also said, these 6 measures of barley he gave me, for he said, do not go to your mother-in-law empty-handed. Then she said, wait, my daughter, until you know how the matter turns out. For the man will not rest until he has settled it today. This is the word of God. So, when you go on vacation, you typically have, personality-wise, you have basically 2 types of planners. Okay, so one is to plan it, you know, sometime, you know, it's down to the minute of what you're going to do and where. Okay, so this type of planner is kind of like a tourist guide, right? Always ushering you from place to place after spending a specific amount of time, you know, at a designated place. As you can guess, the other type of the planner is, well, it is, a planner, but also not exactly a planner. This type goes with the flow and may or may not have an idea of what the day will look like. And so maybe they'll go to one place, and depending on the mood and how they feel, they will stay where they are or to move on to another place. This type will also most likely spend a lot of time on their phones last minute to look up places to go, since generally speaking, there is no specific planning that is done ahead of time. So I don't know for you guys, for your family, what is it like? is do you guys plan, you know, down to the minute, or do you guys plan, you know, kind of as things go? Now, what would you think would happen if Ruth and Boaz were the second type of planner? What if they run everything just on feelings? Well, when you think about it, if they were both feeling types, they would probably not meet in the first place, because that means that for Boaz, he would not be inspecting the field regularly. And that means for Ruth, it means that she would not follow her mother-in-law's instruction to a T. While we already know of Ruth's obedience and also following instructions, for Boaz, his consideration was, you know, as we've seen from last time, as we see the whole chapter 3, where Naomi gave Ruth advice, and Ruth followed and met up with Boaz. And through this whole time, we see that Boaz's consideration, it can be best described as both discretion and also discernment. Okay, so that's the first two D's, if you will. Both discretion and discernment takes into consideration what is best in a particular situation. In this case, it would not be good for Ruth to be seen with him at the late hour, not only for the sake of both of their reputation, but also for the fact that this slip-up may jeopardize the legal proceeding that will take place later on. Because if you remember, there is this matter of the kinsman redeemer, right? So later on, there will be that process. And so what Ruth and Boaz have done at this stage may influence what happens later on. Okay? And so in the same way for us, what we do at any given moment of time, it will have an influence on what happens, you know, later on. And so having discernment and also discretion for Ruth give Boaz the blessing to keep everything above the board. So to be able to discern, to make the best decision in a given situation, to be able to have discernment and discretion from God is very important in our lives. Our Lord Jesus, he showed both divine discernment and discretion as he lived his life on earth. To the woman caught in adultery, he showed discretion. Because if you remember, when the woman that was caught in adultery was brought before him, he did not further shame the woman, but instead, through his actions, He showed the hypocrisy of those who brought the woman to him. And at the end, remember what he said to the woman? He said, "Go and sin no more." So there he showed divine discretion in protecting the woman, but always with the mindset that to encourage and to lead the woman away from sin. He showed discernment. Our Lord Jesus showed discernment when he repeatedly told his disciple and family that his time has not yet come. It is just like Jesus telling his mother at the wedding in Cana that his time, of course, which we know to be his crucifixion and the accomplishment of salvation for all mankind, has not yet come. So as a result, if you remember back to his first miracle, that, you know, besides his mother, besides the servants, both the host and the guest, they did not know where this best wine had come from. So only very few knew what the miracle was, that there was actually a miracle that happened that turned water into wine. Now you might ask, well, why does it matter whether Jesus is crucified earlier or later? And that's a good question. While it may not seem like it makes a difference whether Jesus is crucified later or earlier, Jesus has always been working on a different, if not a divine, schedule. From his timing to be born to his crucifixion and resurrection, right? Why was he born over 2,000 years ago? Why was he not born today in our time? Why was he not born earlier? Not understanding God's timing is no reason to not follow his schedule and revelation. As we look back in our own lives where everything takes place, maybe we wish that, you know, whether it's for those of us who are married, maybe we wish that we met our spouse earlier. Maybe for those of us who are not married yet, we're thinking that, yes, you know, for that to happen earlier rather than later. But no matter what happens, we know that God has ordained everything so that we would meet whether a spouse or our future spouse, that we will meet them at the right time in the right place. If we meet them earlier, we may not be mature enough. And if it's later, maybe situation will change. So we see that in all situations that we see that, you know, yes, you know, we grow in knowledge and we experience, and through those experiences we learn to make decisions. But when I say discretion, when I say discernment, I'm talking about godly discernment, godly discretion. To follow God's leading, to understand when and what decision that we should be making. And so we see that with godly discretion and discernment, that Boaz protected both Ruth's reputation as well as his. And then before Ruth leaves, he said, you know, give me the shawl that is on you. And so he gives her 6 measures of barley. And then so that is what she took back to Naomi, her mother-in-law. And so, of course, as Naomi asked Ruth, you know, how did things go? Ruth related all that has happened, right? How everything went down, so to speak. So the third D then is after, discretion, after discernment comes distribution. Okay, all right. So I know distribution is probably not a common word to use this, you know, in this situation. Maybe gifting or giving might be a better word, but, you know, but work with me here. So we see here that, you know, we already know that Boaz is very generous, right? When they first met, Boaz went to a lot of trouble to make sure that Ruth is taken care of. And here we see it again. We see his generosity, we see his hospitality. And, you know, with what, you know, Ruth had on her time, because she wouldn't have anything else. So she had a shawl, and that is what she, you know, held the barley in. And it doesn't, you know, it probably doesn't hold much, but we know that it's already a lot for Ruth and Naomi. And only when we see Ruth returning to Naomi do we find out that Boaz's intention was not only to be generous towards Ruth, but also to bless Naomi through Ruth by not having Ruth go back to her mother-in-law empty-handed. So what does this mean? This means that for us, that we learned very early on in life that it is natural for us to hoard and not to share or distribute, especially when it comes to something that is hard to find or precious. On our trip, back to Taiwan and in Japan, you know, of course, the kids know by now that there is toys that they can find in the night markets. When you go to Japan, there are the capsule machines, right, where you can, yes, you know exactly what I'm talking about, okay? And so they loved it, you know, to get the capsule, to find different kind of toys. Do you think they want to share what they have? Not at all. Not at all. As parents, we actually, you know, we already have an idea, okay? So, you know, so the more unique the toys are, the harder it is, right? So that's probably also why we learned early on that, you know, if you have one thing for them, they're going to fight over them no matter what, okay? You need to have two or everything. But, you know, even if you have two or everything, sometimes they still fight over it. So there's no end. There's no end. So what Boaz did, then he is like getting the rarest toy from the capsule machine and then giving it to another person and said, here you go, this is for you, instead of hoarding it for himself. So that means that generosity and distribution or giving goes hand in hand. We think of our Lord Jesus, his greatest gift of generosity was to distribute or to give himself for all people by dying for their sins on the cross. And today, the most vivid example and reminder is the communion. There is a reason why we regularly take communion. For some churches, it's, you know, maybe once every quarter. Some partake every week. For us, is monthly. But in all situations, the intention is the same. To be reminded that as we take the sacrament of communion, that we're reminded of what Jesus has done for us on the cross. When we take the communion bread, no matter what forms it comes, I've taken communion bread where it did come in the form of a loaf that you break off. Or in our case, it's communion wafers. But once again, the idea is the same, that we remember that our Lord Jesus, his body was broken for us. When we take the communion cup, in some traditions, you take a common cup. We remember that the blood of our Lord Jesus was shed for us. There is no greater generosity. There's no greater gift than to what our Lord Jesus had offered and gave. The gift of eternity, not just in life, but in a restored relationship with God himself. So we're always fighting in a way against giving, even though we may know in our minds that it is more blessed to give than to receive. But part of our character development, part of what it means to grow, to be part of the redeemed, is learning to give, is learning to share the good news of Jesus, what we have. And after hearing everything that Ruth has related about, you know, what had happened and Boaz's response to Ruth's request, what did Naomi say? Naomi said at the very end, her advice for Ruth was to wait. Because she said, you know, wait and see how the matter will turn out. For the man, will, referring to Boaz, will not rest until he has settled it today. So we don't know from the text how Naomi knows exactly how Boaz is a man of his word. But maybe through this whole time that, you know, while Naomi was not in direct contact with Boaz, but she has heard from Ruth and perhaps from others that she has learned who Boaz is like. On our On our last day in Japan, you know, we had basically a little more than a half day there before we need to head to the airport. And so we were running on a pretty tight schedule. And we were, so in the morning, we were at the one of the flagship Starbucks roasteries. So there are apparently only a few places around the world, and one of them is in Tokyo. So we were there, and we had a dilemma. So while, you know, that place was interesting for adults, we found out that, well, for kids, you know, again, they're just interested in, you know, toys, capsule, and so forth. So we had a dilemma. Do we stay where we are? Do we, you know, linger and enjoy our time there? Or do we move, you know, according to schedule and, you know, move on to the next place? So if you're a planner, maybe you think, well, it's no-brainer, right? We just, whatever the schedule is, then we just follow the schedule. Or maybe you're the feeling type. You say, well, you know, whatever is, you know, whatever's good, you know, if we want to stay longer, we stay longer. For us, it was a dilemma because we know that we're limited in time, but we also want to enjoy our, you know, our time there. So in the end, we choose to stay and enjoy our time, you know, at the roastery to slow down and to, you know, enjoy our last half day in Tokyo. But I think one of the key thing that happened there is to make a decision about what to do, and then to move on with that decision. And everything worked out, you know, pretty well for the rest of our time there. Part of being decisive is to not look back at what could have been, but to accept the consequences of our decisions and to live it without regret, and accept it without regret. At this point, we know that, as Boaz already mentioned to Ruth, that he doesn't know whether he is able to redeem Ruth. But the wisest thing that he could do at this point is to take care of Ruth, to protect her reputation, and to do everything in his power to make sure that Ruth is taken care of. For those of you who are on the indecisive end, of which I am actually part of the club, it is a blessing to be decisive, not only in personal decisions, but also in decisions that impact the kingdom of God, to remain faithful to a ministry, whether it's to commit to serve, you know, despite the challenges. In the midst of, you know, many choices, many decisions to be made, just as Boaz made a decision, even though he doesn't know whether he can redeem Ruth yet, but he made a decision to do what he can. In the same way, we can also, you know, among the many unknowns that we may live in our lives, that we can make every day small decisions that moves us forward, that keeps us on the path that God has set for us. Our Lord Jesus, he showed his human side in the Garden of Gethsemane. If you remember, he prayed to God, that the Father, to let the cup be taken from him. So we know of his struggles because he is fully human after all. But we also seen in our Lord Jesus his divine decisiveness. Because after the struggle, after he had prayed, that ultimately God's will be done. And that is indeed what happened. And that decisiveness took him all the way to the cross, so that in the end he could say that it is finished. It is finished. So if you remember back a little, you know, back to last time, we talked about Boaz's encounter with Ruth. Boaz commended Ruth for her kindness, right? That she has shown a greater kindness to him. And the word used for kindness in the Hebrew word is hesed, okay? So if you don't remember any other Hebrew word, remember this word. Because this word, it means, yes, it means kindness. But in translation, we see it translated as loving kindness. We see it translated as covenant kindness. This is the same word that is used to designate God's covenant love and faithfulness towards his people. It is no accident that Naomi used this word all the way back in chapter 1 and also chapter 2 to describe a God who shows kindness to his people. And in the same way, we see that the full measure of this kindness in Boaz as well. And so the more we read, the more we see godly characteristics such as covenant kindness. Okay, and today we learn that there is, in addition to that, there's also discernment, there's also discretion, there's also distribution, there is also decisiveness. And so just as what we read in school always teaches something and to offer opportunity for us to grow in knowledge, it is not forced on us to learn. We are given the choice. Do we take what we learn and we use it to grow and better ourselves? Or do we ignore it and maybe get a good grade, but to never have learned anything that is useful? In the same way, we see that God's word offers to us, it offers us an opportunity to grow into the son or daughter that we are meant to be. So as we reflect on how we see that these godly characteristics and how God, through the book of Ruth, wants to remind us and to implant this in us so that we can grow in covenant kindness like, you know, our Lord Jesus. We can grow in these four D's. I pray that we can see that, you know, throughout the book of Ruth, remember, this is a book where, you know, God is not explicitly mentioned, you know, in every step or the way or every chapter. But there is no mistake that we see, that there's no doubt that we can see that God is working behind the scenes, because God is the God of Boaz. He is God of Ruth. He is the God of Naomi. And so God not only gives us the gift of God's word, the Bible, he also gives us another gift, which is to read God's word and to receive his blessing by imitating these biblical characters that ultimately all model after our Lord Jesus Christ. So as we close, ask ourselves these questions. Do we lack discretion? Do we say the wrong things at the wrong time? Do we lack discernment? Not knowing how to make godly decisions? Do we lack distribution or giving? Finding it hard to give and to share God's blessings? Or we find that we lack decisiveness, unable to decide without regret. Know that the Holy Spirit will show us where we truly lack these characteristics. And the same Holy Spirit will help us to grow in these areas and many other areas pointed out by the Word of God. So the question posed to us this morning is, do you want to grow? Do you want to be blessed and bless others? I pray that your answer is one that is affirmative. And I pray that God's word will as it is planted in you, that it will grow and mature, and that we are become more and more like the sons and daughters of God, more and more like the redeemed. Let us stand and let us sing, Lord, I Need You, as we respond to God's word this morning.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. When sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you.
Let us pray. Lord, we have learned through experience that there are many times where we made decisions, Lord, thinking that it would be the best for us, it would be the best for our future. Lord, but as we made a decision, as we continue, we realize that those decisions were not only selfish, but it was to the detriment of ourselves and others. Lord, we see both what the decision and its consequences can do to our own lives as well as others' lives. Lord, as we read about how the lives of Ruth and Boaz intertwined, Lord, as we look into the details of their encounter, Lord, time and time again, we see how each of their character, Lord, guided their path. And Lord, you know us better than anyone else. Lord, you know us where we are now. You know us, Lord, where you want to lead us to in a future time. And Lord, while we may not know what happens at a specific point, we know the trajectory. Lord, we know that you're leading us to become more like you. And Lord, whether it's discernment, whether it's discretion, distribution, decisiveness, Lord, you know the areas where we are lacking. And Lord, we thank you because you know our needs. You know what where we lack, where our character needs to grow. So Lord, you use the passage today to speak to us. Lord, I pray that we would not set your word aside. We would not forget about your word, but instead, Lord, we will receive it humbly. And Lord, we would engage with you, that in our hearts we would cry out to you that Lord, yes, Lord, I need discernment, I need discretion, I need a heart of giving, I need decisiveness to make decisions that honor you, to make decisions that may come at a personal cost, but that cost is worthwhile compared to the cost that you suffered on the cross for all mankind. Lord, help us to come away from today's service full of your love, being full knowing that you are a faithful God, and that we can live our lives, Lord, knowing that you are always leading us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the gift of your word, but also the opportunity to grow in your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us receive the benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, may the love of God our Father, may the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now until forevermore. Amen. Please be seated. The Lord be with you.